portraits over and over.
Church. My name is Jesse Peters. I'm the children's pastor here and just want to welcome you. Thank you for joining us this morning. If you're a first-time guest, we would love to connect with you. And so there is a connection card in the pew in front of you. If you would fill that thing out, put it in the offering plate as it's passed around, or you can leave it in the pew beside you and we'll collect those at the end of service just so we can connect with you, just so we can reach out and see how we can be praying with you and offer up some information about who we are here at EBC. Also, there is a first-time guest gift if you are your first time here. It's a mug and some candy and some information about who we are. If you would see the guys at the welcome desk back there on your way out, we'd love to give you that as a gift. So again, thank you so much for being here and choosing us to worship with, and we're excited to worship the Lord together. And so if you would open to the center section of your bulletin, we're going to go through some announcements really quick before we begin our time of worship. First off, there is a meeting tonight. An interest meeting tonight at 7 p.m. in the Fellowship Hall for a Three Circles Evangelism trip to Malawi. And so Harry Schoeneman will be leading that tonight. If you have any questions about that or would like more information about what that is, join us tonight at 7 p.m., but also see Harry Schoeneman for any questions concerning that Three Circles Evangelism trip to Malawi. Next up, we have a CentriKid camp meeting this Wednesday night, immediately following the service. CentriKid is our kids' camp for the summer, and so ages 2nd grade through 6th grade are included. And so if you have any questions or want to know more about what it means to send your kids to camp this summer, join us this Wednesday night, immediately following the service on March 30th. And so we'd love to tell you more about what that looks like going to CentriKid this year. We had a great time last year. It's a wonderful time for your kids, and we'd like you to build your summer vacation around that kids' camp. So come. Also, choir fellowship, Saturday, April 2nd at 11:30 a.m. And so any of our fellowships concerning kids, choir, worship teams, any of those things, we always open those up to anyone who may be interested in serving in those areas. So if you are interested in serving in the choir or singing the choir, have questions or want to connect that way, join us for that. Come to the choir fellowship, or if you're already in the choir, which you're all back there, join us for that. April 2nd at 11:30 a.m. And the meat will be provided, but we ask that you do please bring a side item. Also, Journey Worship Night at Mud Creek, April 9th, 2022, 6 p.m. to 10 p.m. Trey has written on here, he says, you can meet here at 5:30 or at Mud Creek at 6. And so if your students are interested in joining us for that Journey Worship Night, please see Trey with more questions or join us here at EBC 5:30 and Mud Creek at 6 p.m. that night. Also, we have our own Good Friday worship service here with the EBC worship band, and April 15th at 7 p.m. In the sanctuary. Sorry, I couldn't read that font. In the sanctuary at EBC. So I thought it said and Saturday. So anyway, April 15th at 7 p.m., our own EBC worship band will be hosting a Good Friday worship night. Please join us for that. We're excited to worship that weekend together. That following Saturday, April 16th, we have our Easter egg hunt. And so I've said it every week. This is not just a time where we go and we have fun and collect Easter eggs and fill our kids with candy and bright, colorful eggs. We do that, but we do that in an effort to share the gospel with our community, with those who are involved with our Easter egg hunt. And so we will come, collect all the Easter eggs off of this campus, but we will have lunch and we will have the gospel shared that Saturday. And so please join us for that, 11:30 a.m. to 1:30 p.m. that Saturday, April 16th, and we're excited about that. If you're still donating eggs, too, there is collection boxes outside the fellowship hall and right inside the children's building if you'd like to donate eggs and candy for that. And then finally, all of these events, all these things we've got going over the spring and the summer, you can order your EBC t-shirt through the sign-up sheet in the back. if you'd like to have one as we serve in these events. So we like to all wear our EBC shirt so guests and visitors can see who we are and who to come with questions. And so if you don't have an EBC t-shirt, sign up for one of those in the back. Cost is $10 once they arrive. And so excited about that. So anyway, we're excited to continue our time in worship. We have one more brief announcement, and I'm going to hand the mic over to Ken Tadlock for that.
Good morning. So the month of March is known for several things. So in the month of March, we get the first day of spring. We get March winds, March madness. Amen. And we also celebrate Pastor's Wives Appreciation Month in March. So that's what we're here for this morning. So I have the honor of sharing just a few thoughts about the wives of the leaders of our church. So God knew from the beginning that man was going to need help. In Genesis 2:18, the Bible tells us, "Then the Lord God said, 'It is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him a helper fit for him.'" As we all know, if God says something's not good, he knows what he's talking about. So just to remember, and also according to John MacArthur, the words of this verse emphasize man's need for a companion, a helper, and an equal. This points to Adam's inadequacy, not Eve's insufficiency. So God knew that Adam was going to be incomplete without Eve, without his helpmate. So the men God has placed in these positions all work so hard to glorify him and to build God's kingdom here at Ebenezer. With that said, they are not superheroes and cannot do everything on their own. Each one has benefited from the support of their wives in their ministries. And today we want to take a few minutes just to talk and to recognize them. So ladies, on behalf of everyone here today, thank you. Thank you for always having a smile on your face. Y'all need to realize each of these ladies have children at home, young children, teenagers, and even husbands that need help getting here on a Sunday morning. So thank you for always having a smile on your face. Thank you for always being sincere in everything that you say and do. Thank you for serving in so many areas of the church, from the women's ministry to music to the choir, children's ministry, etc. Thank you for making your homes work when your husbands are busy attending to the needs of the church and other families. Thank you for supporting your husbands in their callings physically, spiritually, and emotionally. Thank you for handling the call of being a pastor's wife with love and grace. Thank you for loving God, loving your families, and loving this church. Ephesians 1:15 through 18 says, "For this reason, because I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus, and your love toward all the saints, I do not cease to give thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him, having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints." Ladies, you are appreciated, and please know that you are in our prayers. Remember, when God sent your husbands to Ebenezer Baptist Church, God also sent us you. You are a huge partner in this ministry. So thank you for all that you do. We love you, we appreciate you, and know that we are here for you. God bless. So we do have something for the ladies that we're going to give out during the 11 o'clock service, but we want to make sure that we recognize these ladies here this morning as well. So ladies, when I call your name, if you would, please stand and be recognized. Some of them may already be in Sunday school. So, first of all, Miss Amelia Flynn. She is the wife of Toby, or the minister of families and education. Is she in here this morning? Yeah. There she is. Next, we've got Miss Devin Peters, the wife of Jesse Peters, minister of children. All right. She's with the babies, okay. So then we have Miss Kara Suttles, the wife of Jacob, the minister of music. Cassie Matthews, the wife of Trey Matthews, the minister of students. And also Miss Kristen Blanton, the wife of Pastor Stephen.
You got to stand up.
They're not following the rules this morning. So if y'all would, please tell these ladies how much we love them and thank them.
Man, if you would stand with me, let's say a word of prayer before we go into a time of worship. God, thank you so much for what you're doing in this church, God. Thank you for just for Ken and just what he's shared about these pastors' wives who contribute so much, not only to the church, but to their own families, to their husbands, God. We are appreciative of that. And Lord, thank you for them, God. As we worship you this morning, help us to worship well in a way that is pleasing to you. In your name I pray.
I worship you. in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Stop, you never stop.
for worshiping with us. You all may be seated.
Amen. Well, amen and good morning. We're so grateful that you are with us and want to officially welcome our first-time guest. And we can look around and see several new faces. By the way, thank you so much. One of the greatest, to those of you who are home folks, one of the greatest compliments you could ever pay your church is by inviting your friends. Now think about it. You will not invite any of your friends to something that you don't think is worthy of their time or that embarrasses you. Think about it. You will not invite your friends to anything that you don't think is worthy of their time or that embarrasses you. So thank you. Because you're inviting your friends, you're also communicating to us that this is worth your time, and I'm kind of proud of my church. So thank you so much for inviting your guests and your friends. And for those guests and friends, thank you for coming. You are welcome here, and we are grateful that you're with us today. So in front of you there's a small card. If you would, fill that connection card out. We would love to know that you've gathered with us today so we could maybe put a name with a face. And so welcome. It's good to have you. Hey, I also want to say thank you. We had a small team who gathered yesterday over at the Mission House. Three-church effort between Ebenezer and then Mug Creek and also First Baptist Hendersonville to welcome a refugee family from Afghanistan. And so there's there's so many involved in this effort and different teams. And so thanks to all of you who came out yesterday to help us scrub some floors and get that place spick and span and ready to go for this dear family that we want to love on and show them the name of Jesus. And so thank you for coming. Also, I want to say thank you. She's not in this service, but we forgot just a small portion. Actually, it's actually a big chunk portion, okay? But you've heard me say this, many of you. If Kristen doesn't know it or Tori don't know it, Stephen don't know it, okay? So how many times have some of you come up to me and said, hey, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, ABC, XYZ? And my response to you is, tell Tori or Kristen. Yes, you better tell Tori or Kristen, because I'll never keep up with all of it. And so we have recognized my precious wife, but I also want to say thank you, thank you, thank you. Although she's not in this room right now, I want to say thank you to Tori, all right? So God bless Tori. She puts up with all of us dudes, and she gets the word out to all of our wives to make sure that we are where we need to be. So thank you, Tori. And amen. So we couldn't do what any of us do as a family without Tori keeping us all lined up and together. What?
They couldn't survive without
us. We can't. We know that. We're okay with sharing that. So we absolutely have to have our little sister, and so we're grateful. She's a little sister with all the brothers in the office, and so pray for her. She really needs it, and we're grateful for Tori. All right. Hey, we want to get on with it today. We've got a lot to cover. So if we could, let's have our offering bearers come. Thank you so much for your faithfulness every single week to give. And as always, you can give electronically in the back at the kiosk, or you can give conventionally as the plate passes. But just know there's a lot going on, and we are excited to team up together in that work. One of the easiest ways that you can do that is by giving week in and week out. So trust the Lord as you give today, and we're going to pause right now and ask God to bless and multiply what you give. So let's pray. Father, we realize, Father, that if you don't take the resource and we have and touch it and bless it and use it, it's just another dollar in the plate. But Lord, with your touch, your blessing, your favor on the sacrificial giving of your people, including my family involved, we know, Father, you can do more with what we give than we ever could. You can make what we give go farther than we ever could. It can do more than it could ever do than if we did it by ourselves. So, Father, we give today, first of all, saying thank you for the privilege to give. And we follow that thank you with a simple request. Now take what is given and use it for your glory. You are worthy of it. We pray, God, you be honored in it. And as always, we ask that souls be saved, lives be changed, disciples made for your glory through the giving of your people. In Jesus' name we pray this. Amen.
Jehovah,
seated on the throne. Abba, Father, the well that overflows, the God who was and is and shall be
Victory.
God. Yeah, I hear shouts and claps and words of praise. If you're going to do that, we'll play it again. Amen. That's good stuff. So praise God. Thank you, choir, for leading us in worship today. Amen. What a fantastic job. Go with me to Mark chapter 3. I want you to begin reading with me in verse number 7. Mark 3, begin reading with me in verse number 7. While you're turning there, just by way of a word of introduction and context, verses 7 through 12 really provide for us a snapshot of the entirety of Jesus' ministry. I mean, Jesus is going to deal with some of the stuff he's dealing with today throughout all of his 3.5 years of public ministry. And so I think Mark is very intentionally general here, because I think his point and his purpose is to help you, the reader, understand that this is just what it's going to mean to walk with Jesus. This is just what it's going to be, okay? So look with me, and let's find out what that means in Mark 3. Look with me in verse 7. Jesus withdrew with his disciples to the sea, and a great crowd followed from Galilee and Judea and Jerusalem and Idumea, and from beyond the Jordan, and from around Tyre and Sidon. And when the great crowd heard all that he was doing, they came to him. And he told his disciples to have a boat ready for him, because of the crowd, lest they crush him. For he had healed many, so that all who had diseases pressed around him to touch him. And whenever the unclean spirits saw him, they fell down before him and cried out, "You are the Son of God." And he strictly ordered them not to make him known. Let's pray. Father, we are grateful for the text. I would pray undeservedly and yet humbly in the name of Jesus that you would help me preach it in a way that brings you greatest glory and highest praise. Father, I pray by the very same Spirit that inspired this text that you would now come and instruct this text to our hearts, that we might receive it, be changed by it, apply it, understand it, and be different because we've heard and understood truth today in your word. So, Father, as always, we ask again, Father, from our time, may souls be saved, lives be changed, and disciples made. And I pray for your anointing for the task of making much of Jesus Christ today. In Jesus' name we pray this. Amen. Let's dive right in. There's a few things I want you to see in the text. If you would, turn on the back of your bulletin there. There's a listening guide from you, or for you, rather. And as we follow along in the listening guide, the first thing I want you to see today in the text would be the desperate masses seeking Jesus. I want you to see in verses 7 and 8, let's look at it. Yes, it's very general, but we're going to pause for a moment and try to unpack just a few things. Look, if you would, in verse 7 first. The Bible says Jesus withdrew with his disciples to the sea. Now, when we read verse 7, that's kind of fascinating to me. It's interesting. Because we believe that Jesus is working in and around Capernaum right now. As a matter of fact, when we read in Mark chapter 3, verse 1, the Bible says he's in the synagogue. We believe that's the synagogue in Capernaum. And Capernaum is a fishing village right on the shores of the Sea of Galilee. So when the Bible says that they withdraw to the sea, yes, I am sure that they're probably going to portions and parts of the seashore that are kind of private, that off the beaten path, but he's still on the banks of the Sea of Galilee. He's going to be found. If you have been with us to Israel, you can kind of picture this in your head. If you plan to go with us to Israel, by the way, I need to know that by March 30th. Please hurry. But as we think about Israel, you get down to the little fishing village of Capernaum, and literally right over the bow, if you will, of the city, you can hear the Sea of Galilee washing up on the shore. So as they withdraw from this city, they don't go far because they're still on the banks of the Sea of Galilee, and because of this, a great crowd follows. And notice where they're coming from. They're coming from Galilee, which, by the way, Galilee's a large area. It's not a city. It's a province. It's a section, if you will. It's a county-like. Okay? And so they're coming from Galilee, they're coming from Judea, which is another large province. Jerusalem, that's a city. Idumea, that's a province. And from beyond the Jordan and from Tyre and Sidon. So beyond the Jordan is another provincial area. Tyre and Sidon are two cities in an area known as Phoenicia. So it's up around the Syrian border, modern day. So when the great crowd heard that all he was doing, they came to him. Now let's just pause for a moment. Let's go back to your Bible. Let's appreciate something very quickly, because there's some application we need to bring out of this. So in my Bible, I wrote these numbers. By the way, those maps in the back of your Bible, they're there for more than you just to have something entertaining to look at during the message. When I was a kid and I was bored in church, I would turn in the back of my Bible that my mother compelled me to bring. And in the back of my Bible, while the preacher was up there like the teacher on Charlie Brown, womp, 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 womp. Some of you, that's what you hear every week. So while the preacher is up there giving us the womp, 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 I'm off in another land or bored to tears, looking in the back of the Bible, looking at the maps. I've always been a geography guy. So back there, those maps, they're more than just passing time. They're more for just passing time in the church service. They actually benefit you, because what you can do, as you learn in school, you can take a nice little piece of paper and chart out the length and distances based on the map scale on there at the back. You won't learn this anywhere but Ebenezer. And so what I did just not too long ago, I took a piece of paper and I charted out 150 miles worth of markers on a piece of paper. And then I just started looking up. Okay, Jesus is in Capernaum. How far is that from Galilee? Well, that's about 30 miles total. Capernaum is a part of Galilee, but the outer band of Galilee kind of stretches in a 30-mile radius through there. And so we go to the next city, and then I go down to Judea. That could be anywhere from 80 to 100 miles. We go to the next area, Jerusalem. That's almost exactly 90 miles from Capernaum. Then we go to the next area, Idumea. That can be anywhere from 120 miles plus. Then we go to the next area. They go to Jordan. They're coming from the Transjordan area. Where is that? That's across the Jordan River to where Jordan is today. It's way out there in the east. I mean, that could be anywhere from another 30 to 90 miles. And then they're coming from Tyre and Sidon, which is another 45 to 60 miles. 45 and 60 miles this way, 120 miles south, 30 miles north, coming from 60 to 90 miles east. They're coming from 90 miles in Jerusalem, and they're not doing it in a suburban. Ladies and gentlemen, they're not doing it in a school bus. They're not doing it in a charter bus. When you go to Israel now, you really, one of the things that you have to be very careful of are tour buses. They are everywhere. They're not selling Israeli tours right now. So how are these people getting around? On their feet and on their donkeys. That's not easy travel. Now go with me. Let's just put our feet into the sandals of those in the first century. It's hard enough if you're in total, complete health. If you're a quote-unquote picture of health. It would be hard enough as a picture of health in your late 20s to get on a donkey and either ride the donkey or walk or ride or walk or ride for over 120 miles. I enjoyed riding horses in a younger day of my life. And so we would ride these long trail rides, Virginia, North Carolina, North Georgia, South Carolina. We really enjoyed riding horses. And some of those rides could go 30 and 40 miles a day. You really had to train your horse and build your horse up to those lengths. Because just like a human, they're not really ready for that just by the word go. So you really had to kind of build up for these trips. And so we'd spend a lot of time riding. Well, after you've spent 40 miles on the back of a horse, you get off in this kind of fashion right here. And you're going to stay that way for about 3 hours. That's just 30 or 40 mile trail ride. Imagine you're doing that on the back of a donkey or walking 120 miles. This would have taken days, sometimes weeks. And they keep hearing about this man Jesus. Let's go a step further. There's no social media. There's no billboards. There's no sign on the side of the little path called a road back then that says, blinking sign, Son of God, 10 miles. How does this work? Well, even if you're a picture of health, you're exhausted. You have to pause around every little hamlet and village and say, where is this place called Capernaum? Where is this area called Galilee? Oh, gosh, you're still 60 miles away. Okay. Where is this area called Capernaum? Where is this township called Capernaum within this place called Galilee? Oh, you're just 10 miles north. Keep going. You're close. And so forth and so on. Now, imagine if you're deaf. How do you have someone to ask that question for you? Imagine if you're mute. Imagine if you're blind. Imagine if you have debilitating issues in your legs. Imagine if you have withered body parts. Imagine if you have all kind of sickness and health issues. And for 60 miles, 120 miles, 30 miles, you grope throughout the land of Israel trying to blindly find this man named Jesus. Where are you going with this? All right, here's my point. There's a reason that I entitled the first point as the desperate masses. They're willing to do anything to find somebody who could help them. And ladies and gentlemen, the point I want to make to this church today is there's not a whole lot that's really changed concerning brokenness in the human condition. Sitting in this room today, there might be some individuals. You might not have driven here from 120 miles away, but, you know, as it's often said, a church alive is worth the drive. Some of you might have come from upstate South Carolina. Some of you might have come from portions of the county or counties over west from here. It's the same east from here, the same north from here, wherever you come from. Perhaps some of you today, you walked in this back door and you thought, I don't know what this guy's going to preach, but I hope he's got something for me. My marriage is struggling. My body is deteriorating. I have broken relationships I need to deal with. I have parenting issues. I have financial issues. We could go on and on and on with all the examples as to the reasons why people are broken and hurting. And nothing has changed, ladies and gentlemen. Nothing has changed. The human condition is still the human condition, and people all throughout this county are just like these individuals we read of in the text. They are willing to go to any level, any limit, any cost. I mean, consider this. This is just a hypothetical. Some of you might have done something very similar to what I'm about to describe. Think about you have a terminal type of cancer. And you found out via word of mouth and social media that in Kathmandu, Nepal, some little dude on the side of a mountain up there in negative 10 degree weather has finally found some kind of something that absolutely reverses your condition and heals you. And it didn't just happen with one guy. It didn't happen with 10 guys. There's a repetitive, revolving, cyclical healing. And it's happening in the lives of many. So what are you going to do? I'll tell you what you're going to do. You're going to write letters. You're going to put it on social media. I need to fly to Nepal. Where is that anyway? You'll do whatever it takes. Because that's what we desire. That's what we hope for. Well, let me just tell you something. That was the desperation in the lives of many in the first century. So much so that the Bible says in many times that they pressed Jesus. They thronged Jesus. It was almost a violent press. And they just all but ran him over, which is why you're going to see here in a minute in verse 9 why he asked for a boat. The first verses of chapter 4 talk about Jesus getting in a boat and pushing off from the seashore just so he could teach. We'll deal with that when we get to Mark 4. So I just want to pause for a moment and say this. Be mindful. There's hurting folk all around us. And we are the only organization on the planet that has the answer to their greatest need. No, we may not have the cure for cancer within the walls of this church or in any of our facilities. No, we may not have the cure for some terminal illness. No, we may not have every single answer for every single small little thing that happens within relationships out there. We may not have the answer for every crisis that human beings are dealing with, whether it be physically, mentally, spiritually, emotionally. We may not have specific health, medical science backing up every single thing we say, but that's really, honest to God, that's not what we're called to provide. Because there is a problem and there is condition greater than anything you will face, physically or mentally, and that is a spiritual condition. And for that, we do have the answer. For that, we do have the answer. So listen to me. When we go on mission trips, we're not just going on the mission trip to try to meet all this kind of human need. Now, we're going to do some of that. Nothing is wrong with that. But when we go on mission trips, you might find it disappointing sometimes because perhaps you were on other mission trips and you spent the entire 10 days on your mission trip passing out clothing, and you passed out shoes, and you passed out food, and you distributed this, and you distributed that, and you gave away this. But our mission trips are a little bit different because while we're going to pass out some food and some clothing, we might rebuild a church. We might help someone build a home. We might do all kinds of things physically with our hands, but we're doing it all for one reason. So that by God's grace, we might see a door open to share the reason why we came. And if we don't do that, I'll just be honest with you, we can't outgun UNICEF. We can't outgun the Red Cross. I mean, for crying out loud, we can't outgun the social work of Starbucks. Although I wouldn't agree with all of their social work. They make a pretty good Americano. We're not out there trying to go toe-to-toe with all of the social initiatives across the globe. So why do you go? So we can share this message. You have sin. You're a sinner. And because of your sin, you'll be separated eternally from a holy God unless that sin is forgiven. And the only way that sin can be forgiven is through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And God so loved the world, and he loves you, that he gave his only begotten Son, that if you would believe in him, your greatest problem, your greatest condition, your sin sickness can be healed and forgiven through the blood he shed for you on the cross, and through the power of his resurrection, you can know life change like you've never known it before. And no, you may not get a cure for your cancer, and no, you may not have a cure for whatever debilitating illness you're dealing with, but I promise you this, the greatest cure you need is that of the heart. And I'm here to tell you today that Jesus Christ can heal that problem. And that's the message. And that's why we go to the desperate people of this county. That's why we want to go to the desperate people of this state and this country and anywhere else a door opens across this globe. Because there are desperate, hurting people running to a lot of resources, quote unquote. And just like the woman with the issue of blood, there are people spending thousands and thousands and thousands and bazillions. I kind of smirked this past week because a television commercial came on and it was a medication that is now being prescribed to offset the kickback of other medication. Now we're giving you medication to deal with the side effects of the medication. And listen, I might have to take it one day. I'm not making fun of it. If it'll help me and give me a better quality of life and I can walk with Jesus in a better way, hey, to God be the glory, I'll try it. I'm not picking on any of this. I'm just simply saying there's only so much that we can do for somebody this side of heaven. There is something that we need that is supernatural that only one can give us, and his name is Jesus. Victory has a name, it's Jesus. Holiness has a name, it's Jesus. Healing has a name, it's Jesus. Hope has a name, it's Jesus. The Word has a name, his name is Jesus. And people are willing to walk on foot 120 miles with a debilitating illness, I think that's a level of desperation where they at least be open enough to hear what we got to say. We see the desperate masses seeking Jesus. Number two, we also notice faithful disciples serving Jesus. Look, if you would, in verses 9 and 10. He told his disciples to have a boat ready for him because of the crowd, lest they crush him, for he had healed many, so that all who had diseases pressed around him to touch him. Now, I want to turn your attention back to verse 7, because there's one word there in verse 7 we need to understand so that we can kind of enter the heart of the disciples. Look, if you would, in verse 7, second word of the verse, Jesus withdrew. The word withdrew there means to quickly seek shelter, to get out of Dodge. There's an urgency. Like, I don't know how it looked. I don't know when they decided to do it. Perhaps one morning before the sun came up, Jesus is shaking all his disciples. He'll have to do that again one night. He's just shaking all his disciples. Come on, let's go. Where are we going? Get up. Maybe in the wee hours of the morning, they get up, they leave the city, they're making their way out to the shores of the Sea of Galilee, and the Bible says they withdraw. The idea of the word withdraw has to deal with sanctuary. It has to deal with quietness. It has to deal with a place of rest. So why are Jesus and his disciples going here? Well, there's been a lot of stress. There's been a lot of issues already. And we believe this is the first year of his public ministry. He's got 2.5 more years to go. But already, Jesus is causing a little bit of a ripple and a little bit of a wave. And so he looks at his disciples one day and he says, come on, we just got it. We're going. Let's just go. And so I'm sure many of the disciples were even thinking, some uninterrupted time with Jesus. This is when we get to ask questions and hopefully get explanations. And guess what? They didn't get it. Have any of you ever went on a vacation and something happened that killed your vacation? Anybody? Or has that only happened to preachers? Anybody? Best vacation ever had in my life. It was day one. We had just gotten to the beach. And so, man, I'm just so excited to get there. But I'm sorry. Good Baptists don't go to the beach. We got to the coast. And so I went to the coast. And there I got out of the car, and I already had my swimming trunks on. And, I just threw my shirt off, and we got a little chairs out. And here I go, like a little seven-year-old, just running through the waves. And I just dive in, and like, this is wonderful. And then when I stand up, I feel something in my pocket. Man! Stupid phone. I fried that sucker. They will not hold up to salt water. I'm just telling you right now. They just don't like it. And everybody was like, well, just put it in some rice. It'll dry out. Yeah, well, 42 years later, it's still soaked, okay? It don't work. Maybe it does. Maybe it doesn't. It didn't help me. We did everything from soak it in rice to blow a hairdryer over it. Best vacation in years. No one could get me. I used Kristen's phone. I called back to the church. I said, look, my phone's dead, and unless somebody is dying or hurting or screaming, don't call me because I'm not going to get it anyway. It was a very quiet 7 days. It was amazing. Well, this didn't happen for Jesus and the disciples. And there was no cell phones back then, but there was word of mouth, and the word had gotten out. And so instead of withdrawing to finally find a little bit of a break, they didn't get that at all. As a matter of fact, Jesus has to look into the eyes of his disciples for another time and say, well, boys, the break we had hoped to have is no longer an opportunity. You see the crowds, but here's what I need you to do. I need you to go secure a boat, get it up here, and you need to move in a hurry. So automatically, in a moment, it went from break with Jesus to serving again. Now we're looking for a boat. And you know, I begin to ponder about this, and I have the opportunity. And it is an opportunity and a privilege that I take with so much honor that I get to teach down at Fruitland Baptist Bible College. Now, what I'm about to say is not indicative for every student down there. It's not. But it is for a handful. And here's something that I hear from time to time. Well, I just can't wait till I get a ministry. I just can't wait till I find a ministry. Let's keep looking for a ministry. So my thought is, well, hey, buddy, I can help you with that. We got a church that's about 4 miles from this front door. And we need help in children's. Well, you know, it's really what I feel called to. Okay? Well, good news. You're studying to be a Bible college student. We wouldn't mind you coming in and maybe doing like some apprentice type stuff, maybe learn what it means to do some teaching, and maybe even after a few months, maybe even step into a teaching role. You can help us out while you're here. Well, I don't even know if that's really what I'm called to right now. And we get really spiritual about all this calling. I don't know if Sunday school class, what I'm really just waiting on a ministry. Okay? Well, we have many Bible studies which deal with a lot of issues in people's life. Perhaps one of those. Well, you know, I'm just really waiting on a ministry. You know what the ministry for the disciples was? Hey, I need you to go find me a boat. Okay, then what? That's it. Just go find me a boat. Okay, when we get the boat, so what are we going to do then? I want you to wait. So I left a tax booth. I left my own company with the fishing deal to go find you a boat. Yes. And then you want me to wait. That's it. So I just begin to think about this text in this passage. Can I just ask you something? Just hypothetically. If you're like a handful of those individuals down there at the Bible college waiting on the ministry, what in the name of common sense are you waiting on? Are you waiting on the day when God says through the expired spirit of Billy Graham coming back from the dead, you're the next one. You'll be the anointed crusader out there bringing the billions to your events. There's an arena in Charlotte, North Carolina. Walk into the gate and start preaching. And then the security guys will lock you up because they have no idea who you are. Well, what are we waiting on? Are we waiting for the day when someone calls and says, you know what, we had a nationally known speaker for this thing, and man, we've already got the pamphlets printed, and your picture won't be there, but we'd love to have you preach at this event. There'll be about 22,000 plus. You got time? I mean, what ministry are we waiting on? There's ministry all around us. There's ministry in front of us, behind us, beside us. What ministry are you waiting on? Because sometimes Jesus is just hoping that he can call somebody and give a simple task like, hey, I need you to, can you find me a boat? Or maybe to some of you he would say, hey, that vehicle you got, that's mine, right? Hey, that tractor you own, how can you use it for my glory? Hey, those trucks you have. Hey, that equipment you have. Hey, those houses you own. Hey, that resourcing that you know about. Would you be willing to turn that over to me? And sometimes we put up a guard there because that doesn't sound ministerial enough. But I'm just telling you, when you serve him with Jesus, sometimes the ministry is have your day interrupted with more people who are needy. And the request out of the ministry is, hey, we're going to need you to pick up this Saturday. There's a phrase I love to use. When Jesus told his disciples to go into the city on the day of Passover, we'll read it later, he sent his disciples, just two or three of them, and he said, you'll see a donkey, and beside that donkey there'll be a young foal. Untie the foal, and when the master of the foal says, what are you doing? Just simply look at him and say, the master hath need of it. I love that phrase. So listen to me. When I, as the preacher, come up to you and say, hey, we might need you pick up this Saturday, the master hath need of it. We might need you to help us scrub some floors. You know what happened yesterday with about six people on some hardwood floors? The equivalent of Jesus saying, can you go find me a boat? That's what it is, and it ain't pretty, and it ain't glamorous, and a lot of people won't know about it, and your name will never be printed in a program, and your picture won't be planted all over social media, but my friends, that is ministry. And if that's what you're looking for, we got a lot of that for you around here. And the disciples did it. That's what it means to be a disciple of Jesus. To give your days to him, to give your time to him, to give your possessions to him. And then as he summons those resources, make them available to him. Number three, as we go home. Oh, no, as you go to Sunday school. I do it every week. Look in verse 11. We get out of here, go to Sunday school. Verse 11, whenever the unclean spirits saw him, they fell down before him and cried out, "You are the Son of God." And he strictly ordered them not to make him known. Again, I want you to look at just one word as we go home today. Look in verse 11. Look at the word cried. They cried out. This was not warm and fuzzy cry out. This is not overwhelmed by the authority of God and warmed in the heart types of, "You are the Son of God." No, as a matter of fact, the most literal rendering of the word of cried is a scream or a shriek. So when the Bible says the demons saw him, they begin to scream and shriek through their host, "You are the Son of God." That's the best shriek I can give you. I could probably do better, but your ears can't take it. They just begin to loathe. There's anger, this visceral, deep hatred for Jesus comes out of their host. So as they're recognizing him, they begin to cry out all the more. And Jesus says, "Be quiet." Why does Jesus do that? Well, we don't know exactly what the motives are of these demons and evil spirits, but we, number one, we know that they're real. And number two, we know that demons and evil spirits have nothing to do or want nothing to do with God and the things of God. And so we have to believe, knowing the sinister mindset of hell and all its forces, we have to believe that the reason they're shrieking this and crying out is to some detriment to the name of Jesus. Perhaps they're trying to turn attention to this man named Jesus so the Pharisees will increase their pressure against him. Perhaps they're trying to cry out and give attention to Jesus so that his popularity increases even more. I mean, even now, how many times has Jesus done something and said these words, "Tell no one what I did to you"? He heals the leper, don't tell anybody. They cry out all the more, "Be quiet." Why is Jesus keeping this quiet? Because there's a lot of work yet to be done. Jesus did not come to be the popular favorite among the people. He came to be the Son of God to die for them. And there was a lot of work to be done before the cross would ever be endured by the Son. We see Jesus conquered enemies that were confessing him. When Jesus speaks, they have to be silent. Now listen to me. What they're saying is right. And it makes me think of James chapter 2, verse 19. You say that you believe. Well, good for you. It's almost like James is saying, good job. Good for you. Even the demons believe and tremble at the name of Jesus. You say you believe there's a Savior, and yet nothing in your life is following the commands of Jesus. Well, you're no better than the demons. Because even the demons shrieked with their hatred and say, "You are the Son of God." They believe these truths about him. They believe that he's real. They believe that he's there to subject his authority over their existence. But they don't believe him unto faith or salvation. So just having a belief about Jesus is not enough. There has to be a belief that results in action driven by faith, and that is the genuine nature of a heart submitted to God. And I want you to understand something. It's not enough just to say the right things. There's a lot of folk in churches saying the right things, but their heart never unites with the right things said and the right things done, driven by faith, true saving faith in the Son of God. I'm reminded of the last few chapters of the Bible. In Revelation 1, the Bible says that Jesus has the voice as the sound of many waters. It'd be the equivalent of trying to go up to the base of Niagara Falls on the little boat and talking over the falls. That's the sound of many waters. It's a roar. It shakes you to your core as you hear that sound. There's nothing like it. There's nothing you can compare to it. It's just an overwhelming roar. And the Bible says that can be likened to the voice of Jesus. So no one will be able to stand before the throne of God and say, don't I deserve this? Or didn't I do that? Or was I not good a person enough to be in heaven today? No, at that point, you will hear the voice as the sound of many waters say exactly what he said he would say in Matthew 7. Depart from me, you worker of iniquity. I never knew you. I might know you as a human being existed on the planet. And you might have said some things, but even the demons have said that about me. But I don't know you as my child. So ladies and gentlemen, I'm not trying to scare you into anything today. I'm just simply trying to tell you, it's not enough just to believe something about Jesus. That belief has to result in action driven by faith. And that's when it starts counting with Jesus. The Bible says, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. The demons were doing it here because they hated Jesus. One day, they will do so totally because of the authority of Jesus. But today, you've got a free will opportunity to confess him. Who is Jesus to you? Are you one of the broke masses needing a touch from the Son of God? What are you willing to do? There were some people willing to travel over 120 miles on the back of a donkey with a debilitating illness to get help from Jesus. Don't tell me. I'm just going to get honest with you. Not that I ain't been telling you the truth before, but really, I'm really getting honest now. When a preacher comes out from behind the pulpit and says, let me be honest with you, we're like going another level of honesty. We're going to uber honest right now. Please, don't tell me you're wrong, Ryan. It's 24. What's 24 times 3? 72? People got on the back of a donkey and traveled 120 miles because they were so broken to meet the Son of God. Don't tell me 72 feet's too long. Give me a break. Don't tell me 72 feet's too long for you to come and have an experience with the Son of God. Come on. If you'd like to meet him, here's the good news. He's available. If you'd like to talk with him, the altar's open. If you'd like for someone to counsel and pray with you, there'll be a brother to my left or my brother and sister to my left and my right. If you're a female, if you'd like to talk to a female, she'll be up here. If you're a brother, you'd like to talk to a male, he'll be up here. If you'd like to talk to the pastor, I'm here. You have no reason. You have no excuse under heaven to keep pushing back what the Son of God might be doing in your life. Come on now. There were some willing to cover weeks on foot just to get their problem met by Jesus. Right now in this moment, you got that opportunity. Let's stand together. Father, thank you so much for your grace and the opportunity and the privilege we have right now. We ask and pray, Lord Jesus, please, may the Spirit of the living God stir our hearts for this moment. And as you see fit, please, God, if we need to respond in faith, confessing Jesus Christ, not just saying the right things about him. The demons did that and trembled and shrieked and hated his name, but they said the right things because they knew who they were dealing with. Saving faith is much different. It's a great deal of difference between shrieking out the name Son of God and in brokenness whispering the same words of faith. Father, I pray if there be any today who feel led to join this church, any today who feel led to step out and say, I want to be saved, I want to know Jesus Christ, I'm ready to nail this down. I want my brokenness of sin healed through Jesus this morning. Let them have the courage. Step out. Walk a very short aisle and confess their need for Jesus. If anybody just need to come pray, we pray for courage to do that now. Lead us for your glory. Jesus, thank you that you do not withdraw from us. You do not take vacations from our desperate need for you. And even now, through your death and resurrection, you're available for any who would call you. Whether in the pew or at the altar, we pray, hear our cry. In Jesus' name we pray this. Amen. Let's sing this as our hymn of invitation. Please, you come. You need to pray. You want to join. You need to be saved. You come. Let's sing this to the Lord. I just want you to know, Jesus is as close as you desire him to be. The Bible says in Revelation 3:20, he stands at the door of your heart and he knocks. And if you be willing to open it, he'll come in and be with you. The Bible says he'll sup with you. That means he'll spend time with you, feed you through who he is and what he's promised, if you're willing to open the doors of your heart. So I want to pray for you today. And then we're going to sing one chorus of My Chains Are Gone, and then we'll be dismissed if no one needs to move. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you so much for the good news of the cross of Calvary. Thank you for the Son of God, that he died for us and rose again. He was not too busy, nor demanded that he needed a break, so much so that he withdrew from humanity, always available, always there, to change the hearts of those who would trust him by faith. Lord, that brokenness is still a truth and a reality of our life today, but so is the truth and reality of Jesus. Working in the Spirit of God through the Word of God, Jesus Christ is still available to change lives. And I thank you and trust that you've done so in the hearts of some today. For your glory and your honor, we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing that one chorus as we close today.
My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy reigns. I'm ending now. Amazing.
If you'll step right here. Nick, can I share? I'm going to anyway. You might as well say yes. Okay, good. You know how this works now. All right, I'm going to stand here because I'm vertically challenging. Y'all tall. All right. So we have Justin and Jessica, Avely, Luke. Got it. And this is the McKenzie family. They've all placed their faith in Jesus Christ, and all but little Avely have been baptized. But Avely said that they should be willing to be baptized at a later date and time here. So upon their profession of faith and Avely's soon-to-be baptism, do we have a motion to receive them in our fellowship today? Amen. And if you'd be willing to say, hey, I'll love you as a family in the family of God. I'll go with you on mission, and I'll learn with you to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. Let them know that. Say, I'm with you. Amen. Amen. Let's welcome the McKenzies today. Amen. You guys can be seated right there or stand up. My man, Nick. Nick has been a dear friend to Trey for quite some time. And I think yesterday you guys had a long, extended talk. And so today, nailing that thing down, Nick has placed his faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. And so Nick lives out of town, and so we're going to try to do our best to help our brother connect with a church that's healthy, that he can grow in out of town. But we're looking forward to a day, maybe here sometime soon, when Trey, because Trey's done the hard plowing there and loving this old brother, Trey can baptize his one of his best friends in the name of Jesus. And so, brother, we welcome you and we love you. God bless you so much, and congratulations. Amen. Best decision you ever make, following Jesus. I love you. I hope you have a wonderful week. Hey, listen, if you ever see, I'm going to make this announcement be done. If you ever see people sliding out around the 10:30 mark, it's not just because of the bad preaching, all right? They've got to serve in other places, and people are waiting on them. So please, just know that they're not doing that to be a distraction to you. They're just slipping out so they can go serve somewhere. And so God bless them for what they're doing. I love you. We'll see you Wednesday night, 6:30.
One more step, one more exhale, as I far away leave. Feel my heart as it's racing down the path you set for me.